So in the last Friday episode, we talked about how we could modify Starship in a straightforward way to make our future flights to Mars safer and to reduce health risks for our future Mars settlers. But today, we want to start to think about how exactly SpaceX actually wants to colonize Mars.
What exactly is Elon's plan to build the first settlements on Mars? How will the timeline look? Where will the first base be built? And how exactly will the first base be built? And how will it actually look? Well, I would say, let's find out.
This is the first video of a four-part series, which we do in collaboration with our good friend, The Angry Astronaut. We are really happy to do this collaboration. And you can watch the second video on his channel next week. His video will discuss Mars colonization efforts, apart from SpaceX and Elon Musk, especially NASA's Mars projects and plans. So be sure to check out his channel after you watch this video here. And yes, he's not a fan of PC culture either, which is a strong motivation for this collaboration in the first place. Anyways, so how exactly does Elon want to make Mars settlement a reality?
Well, we all know that Starship will be the vehicle which will allow us to live on other worlds. Starship is the only vehicle in development which has the necessary payload capability, namely 100 metric tons to the surface of Mars per trip. In order to get there, we know that Starship is currently being built and tested at Boca Chica. That's right, what we see here are really the first steps towards the colonization of Mars. The first extremely important milestone for Starship will be to demonstrate an uncrewed orbital flight, hopefully later this year or in early 2021. Then, we think Elon will test Starship on an uncrewed round trip around the Moon, possibly by late 2021 or early 2022, depending of course on when the Super Heavy booster will be ready. In 2023, we might see a first uncrewed landing of Starship on the Moon as a demonstration mission to secure further funding from NASA for their Artemis program. We also will see the Dear Moon mission with Yuzaku Mitsawa around the Moon in 2023. Make no mistake, because all these Moon missions will test crucial systems of Starship for Mars. Orbital refueling, for instance, will also be needed for Moon landings, so it is crucial that this technology is available before the first Mars missions.
The cost of refilling your spaceship on orbit is tiny. And you can get 150 tons all the way to Mars. So automated rendezvous and docking and refilling, absolutely fundamental.
We think that orbital refueling will be tested around 2022. It remains to be seen if that will happen in time to send two uncrewed cargo starships to Mars still in the 2022 launch window, as Elon planned it initially.
That's our goal, is to try to make the 2022 Mars rendezvous.
We try to remain realistic here. So we think, no. Elon also planned the first human missions to Mars in 2024, which we could probably all agree on is absolutely out of the question.
So then in 2024, we want to try to fly four ships, two of which would be crewed, and two cargo and two crew.
The chance of that happening is below 0.1% in our opinion. We can be very happy if Starship can land the first humans on the Moon in 2024. Something which Elon, by the way, basically also confirmed in a tweet. The Moon will be the testing ground for future Starship Mars missions.
Based on the calculations we've done, we can actually do lunar surface missions with no propellant production on the surface of the Moon. So if we do a high elliptic parking orbit for the ship and re-tank in a high elliptic orbit, we can go all the way to the Moon and back with no local propellant production on the Moon.
We think that orbital refueling and the lessons learned from the first Moon missions will allow Starship to carry out the first cargo missions to Mars in 2024. The first two cargo starships might already also take payloads with them for the future Mars base. However, it could happen that these two starships will just carry some dummy payloads in order to test the system in 2024. So we don't risk losing any valuable payloads in the very first attempt of Starship landing on the red planet. Because let's be realistic, there's quite a high likelihood that the first attempt of Starship landing on Mars wouldn't be successful. Something somehow nobody wants to talk about. But you know us, we like to say inconvenient stuff sometimes. So after Starship has successfully demonstrated that it can safely aerobrake in the Martian atmosphere and can safely land, then we think we will see the first real cargo missions to Mars. The next launch window will be in early 2027. We assume that by that time, we will see the launch of more than two Starships. Because SpaceX will be aware that everything took a few more years than initially planned. So in order to make up for this, in 2027, we might see more than two Starships depart for Mars. Maybe even four or more. By that time, more lessons learned from the Moon missions will be applied to the Mars Starships. And Starlink will be producing huge revenues for SpaceX, enabling them to start to build giant fleets of Starships. Currently, the Erebus Montis region is the favored site for our first future Mars base. It is ideal for several reasons.
First of all, it has a very low elevation, so it's very low lying. Therefore, the atmospheric pressure is higher, which provides better protection from cosmic rays, thus reducing the radiation exposure. The radiation exposure difference on Mars can actually vary dramatically. As we can see on this radiation map here, Erebus Montis lies here, so the radiation dose equivalent would be around 13 rems per year, which corresponds to 0.13 sievert per year. So 7.7 years outside stay time on Mars would correspond to a dosage of 1 sievert, which is regarded as the maximum lifetime safety limit. This can of course be further reduced to negligible levels by living in habitats which are surrounded by 3D printed regolith domes, a method which we currently favor, as this would really reduce cosmic radiation exposure to absolutely zero. Now, another reason why the Erebus Montis site is so excellent is that this water map here shows that there are giant subsurface water ice reserves in that area. And water ice is, as we know, essential for a Mars base, but also for a moon base. Not only to provide drinking water and water for the hydroponic farms, but also to generate oxygen for breathing and hydrogen for propellant production. The hydrogen reacts at 400 degrees Celsius and high pressure with the CO2 from the Martian atmosphere via the famous Sabatier reaction, and thus creates methane fuel for Starship.
For Mars, you will need local propellant production. But Mars has a CO2 atmosphere and plenty of water ice that gives you CO2 and H2O. So you can make, therefore, CH4 and O2 using the Sabatier process Sabatier process.
Another reason which speaks for the Erebus Montis site is that it's still not too far north, so the sun is still powerful enough for large solar arrays. And on top, lava tubes are also nearby, which could provide additional possibilities to build subsurface bases, and of course, because lava tubes are the most promising location to find Martian fossils, or maybe even some primitive Mars life, such as bacteria, or with any luck, maybe even a bit higher developed life.
So after the first cargo starships have landed on Mars in 2027, carrying many probably expandable habitat modules with them, power generation in form of solar arrays and radiothermal isotope generators, propellant production machines, maybe even a boring machine, and then of course a couple of Cybertrucks. Because come on people, we need a Mars version of Cybertruck. Then for sure also hydroponic modules. Kimball will certainly gladly provide some. And also lots of 3D printers of course. Because many parts will be manufactured on site using Martian regolith. For example, the protection domes over the habitat modules could easily be printed by 3D printing robots. All this is absolutely essential cargo to build our first Mars base. By the way, Elon mentioned multiple times that SpaceX will only get people to Mars. So the cargo carried by Starship probably won't be SpaceX's own equipment. We think that many companies will want to contribute to the first Mars base, as it would be a giant investment opportunity for the future. Of course, synergies with Elon's other companies, such as the Boring Company or Tesla, would be extremely likely. The Boring machines are just perfect for Mars. Then a Mars rover version of the Cybertruck, and also Tesla solar arrays and Tesla batteries, and maybe even Neuralink VR, in case someone might miss Earth a lot.
We think, and these are by the way just our estimations based on more realistically sounding Elon time adjustments, that 2029 will then be the year where the first Mars settlers will be sent to Mars in a fleet of starships. How many is anyone's guess, but we talked in our previous Mars Starship series of videos, which you can watch right here, that a maximum of 30 people per starship would be advisable. So let's say 10 crew starships will launch for Mars in 2029, so a total of 300 people, and of course a few additional cargo starships. They would arrive on Mars the same year, hopefully by the way enjoying artificial gravity and radiation protection on the way, as we also suggest in our videos. And then we would witness the first footsteps of humans on Mars in 2029. This is still quite optimistic, by the way, so don't be sad if it will be 2031 or even 2033. But this is still infinitely better than anything we could have ever hoped for before Elon came along. Anyways, so now the first settlers will immediately get to work and build up the base. They will land near the cargo starships, which will have landed in 2027, and unload the cargo from those starships, but also from the ones which have landed together with them. First, the regolith domes will have to be built. Or maybe there won't be regolith domes, instead just very good shielded habitat shelters, like this proposal here called Marsha from AI Space Factory. We still would prefer domes for better cosmic ray protection though, such as proposed for example by Hassel, or this one here by Search Plus and Apis Core. These would completely eliminate the cosmic radiation problem altogether. After setting up the habitat modules, power generation would be paramount. The solar arrays will be set up together with the radiothermal isotope generators. Solar arrays alone won't suffice, because you know there are quite gigantic dust storms on Mars from time to time, which can last for many months, completely darkening the sky and also covering solar arrays with sand. So we will also additionally need radioisotope generators. After power goes online, the hydroponic modules will be attached to the base.
After that, water extraction machines will be set up, followed by propellant production machines.
The goal of these initial missions is to find the best source of water. That's for the first mission. And then the second mission, the goal is to build the propellant plant, a large array of solar panels, very large array, and then everything necessary to mine and refine water, and then draw the CO2 out of the atmosphere, and then create and store deep cryo CH4 and O2.
So after the first Mars base has been set up and is running smoothly, the next wave of cargo starships and settlers would arrive. More and more starships will be launched in each launch window about every 2 years. Then at some point in the 2030s, we think the next generation Starship 2.0 will enter production, which will have 4 times the interior volume of the first generation Starship, and much higher payload capacity. More and more Mars settlers will thus arrive in the late 2030s. In 2029, 300 people will have arrived in our scenario. In the late 2030s, with Starship 2.0, 10,000 people could arrive in each launch window.
then build up the base, starting mostly with one ship, then multiple ships, then start building out the city, then making the city bigger, even bigger.
And in the late 2040s, tens of thousands of people would arrive during each launch window. Therefore, having over 100,000 people living on Mars by 2050 is achievable. We think that 1 million would be a bit over the top, but 100,000 is certainly doable. However, by 2060 or 2070, 1 million people might be achievable, and 10 million by 2100 is certainly within the realm of possibility. After that, we can start to think about terraforming Mars. But this will be the topic for another episode.
So do you think our Mars colonization timeline is too optimistic or too pessimistic? Or are you even a hardcore Elon believer and say that yes, we will send humans to Mars in 2024?
And be sure to check out our friend the Angry Astronauts channel for the second video.
And if you have missed our Starship Flawfix series, where we talk about how to overcome the radiation problem or the zero-g problem on trips to Mars, you can watch the videos right here.
So thanks for watching, and I'd say, on to the future! Can you see it again? It's a bit more emphasis.
Now the famous disruption report stuff again? So
Or should I say something like...
Talk about how to fix...
So thanks for...
Sorry.